Velocity Merchant on Dr. Quinn, Medicine Woman. His real name was Dallas Burroughs, but he decided Orson Bean was funnier. Sam Litzinger, CBS News.
When your child is struggling to read, you can hear the frustration in their voice. As a parent, you feel helpless and discouraged.
Homework time was always a very stressful time for Eddie, not to mention us. It seemed every night he was going to bed in tears.
She would stumble on words, she would drop sentences, go down two sentences, come back, jump around. No matter what you did, it continued.
The USA Reading Clinic is looking for dedicated parents and kids who are committed to overcoming these challenges. Without the proper help, your child is at risk of being left behind. But with our proven technology, your child can flourish as a reader.
Eddie can now read, he's processing, he's understanding, and he's retaining. His grades are going up, too.
To find out if your child is eligible, call now for a free consultation. Space is limited. Call the USA Reading Clinic at 800-230-3054. That's 800-230-3054. 800-230-3054.
The following program is a paid presentation. The views and or opinions expressed do not necessarily reflect those of the staff and management of KWAM.
Ow! This is the S to the K to the double E to the T to the E to the R, and I'm sitting here with the F to the O to the R to the D, and we're in the house today. And Gwen is in the great state of Mississippi.
Thank you for the introduction.
Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome, Dolores. This is the Unleashed Voice Radio Show, the liveest show on KWAM 990 Talk Radio, the new 107.9, where we educate, empower, and enrich the community. Today we have a guest via phone. He's going to bless us with some information. I don't want to prolong this great interview, but we have this young man on the phone by the name of Darwin Thompson. He's the Associate Director of Corporate Giving at Gilead Science. What's up, my brother?
What's going on, man?
How you doing?
Happy to be here.
Thank you.
I'm good.
Well, I know you're big time now. You have a schedule like President Obama, so I don't want to hold you. I want to jump straight into this great interview with you.
Oh, man, I'm not big time. I'm happy to be here with y'all, man. Y'all my people.
That's what's up, man. So tell us what is going on with this the age-positive initiative that Gilead is putting forth right now.
Yeah, so our HIV age-positivity initiative is a three-year commitment where we have given right under $18 million to 30 organizations throughout the United States that really focuses on three key areas.
Okay.
One being, you know, wellness and empowerment for people over 50 living with HIV to increase their isolation. I mean, to decrease their isolation, because our advisors told us that isolation within aging populations is really significant, especially with those who are living with HIV.
Mm-hmm.
Also to coordinate care. You would be surprised that a lot of people over 50 who are living with HIV, they're going to three and four doctors to deal with any type of chronic illnesses that they're dealing with. Maybe it's their frailty, their HIV, or their diabetes. And so really looking at how do we coordinate care for those populations, and then some of that policy and advocacy work. So really thinking about changing systems within laws and governments to really protect the rights of people over 50. And I think the thing that's going to be interesting is, I'm not sure if you know this, but the data shows that right around 50% of people living with HIV are over 50, right?
Okay.
And so by 2030, it'll be right at 70%. And so we know that HIV is now a chronic disease and it's not a life-threatening disease anymore. And so we need to be focusing on the whole health of individuals versus just managing their HIV. And so that's kind of how we birthed this HIV AIDS Positivity Initiative. It's a really thing about the whole health of people over 50 now and not just the HIV diagnosis.
So why are we focusing on people aging with HIV?
I mean, think about it. So when, if you think about the epidemic from, you know, the inception, a lot of those people who saw their family and friends die in the early 80s, late 80s and early 90s have now been living with them. And so some of the things that they potentially thought they could do, like have kids or have family, you know, has put them in a place where they aren't able to live what we consider healthy lives.
Okay.
Or someone like yourself could be a healthy life, could live a healthy life. So we want to be able to ensure that all people have, you know, healthy lives. And so when we think about over 50, again, our medications has really turned HIV into a chronic illness.
Right.
And so people aren't really addressing some of those other concerns over for people over 50. And so we're taking this initiative to take a step further to say we got them to be healthy, but we need to start addressing those other social determinants, from housing to, again, isolation, to some of those other social determinants that could potentially reduce their health, the impact on their health and wellness.
So I was reading the other day, and as you know, we as African-American, black folk, we represent 12% of the population here in the United States, but we represent a large number of the new diagnoses of HIV and AIDS here in the southern states and abroad as well. So the initiative that Gilead has pushed forward, is it really focusing on the southern states or the northern states here in the U.S.?
So, I mean, I think there's a combination, right? So when if we're speaking of HIV and our HIV AIDS Positive Initiative, it's a domestic initiative. So
gotcha.
We have grantees in New York and Texas and California, Connecticut. But when we think about what we're doing in the southern, and I may be going ahead, but when we think about what we're doing in the southern United States, you know, in 2017, Gilead launched our Compass Initiative, which is a $100 million commitment to reducing HIV in the southern United States. And so when we think about our signature programs at Gilead, we have a number of things that we're doing to end the HIV epidemic, from the work that we're doing in the South, to the work that we're doing within trans communities, to the work that we're doing for people over 50. So I think they all work together. And they could be pinpointed to, again, some of our organizations that are working on HIV and aging are in the South. And so we have resources that we're kind of triaging and putting in places where we think the burden is the highest.
Okay, so we have a lot of our listeners who troll our station, and they listen to our show, and so they may not know who Gilead Science is. So can you get them a quick definition? Matter of fact, our engineer in the studio, she doesn't know who Gilead Science is. So can you give us a quick definition on who Gilead Science is?
So we are a biopharma company that focuses on curing life-threatening diseases. So if you think about hepatitis C, so we were the manufacturer who put products out for that, you know, effectively cured hepatitis C. We make, you know, HIV medications. We also make medications for the flu or for hepatitis B and other diseases that affect Americans. And so we just are a pharmaceutical company that really looks to prevent diseases for Americans, both domestically and globally.
Great. So back to the HIV AIDS Positively program. What does success look like for this program and the individuals involved?
So, I mean, I think there are a couple of things that success would look like, right? So I'll give you a really tactical and micro thing of what success was like. If we look at what one of our grantees did in Illinois, Illinois is one of those states where we're working with SAGE out of New York, and they worked with the legislators in Illinois to make sure that people over 50 living with HIV are a protected population, and to ensure that they had some rights and protections as they get older. So that's a win, because we want to ensure that there's additional benefits for people over 50 living with HIV. And so then those, what happened in Illinois, can now trickle down to other states. So looking at California and D.C. and New York, and seeing how we can replicate what the success is in Illinois. So that's a very specific example.
Okay.
But then when we look at, when we look at organizations who are working with other population, with other aspects of the grant, is, you know, how many people are reducing their depression? Mm-hmm. How many people who are isolated, you know, are now in social groups? Because again, you know, when we're saying over 50, mm-hmm. you know, we are still thinking about, you know, I interviewed someone a few months back who had been living with HIV for about 30 years, but he was in his 70s. And so thinking about reducing some of those social determinants that affect him, and so bring him out of isolation, putting him into groups where he can, you know, create friends or create networks. Mm-hmm. And so I think success is going to be, you know, identifying specific outcomes and targets that we can measure within communities, and really highlighting those things.
Yeah, because studies have shown people with HIV over 50, they have higher rates of depression and decrease, like you said before, to access to proper care. So I think that's great, the success measures that the program is aiming at, and they will get there. And so that is awesome, and I love it. What about the education piece? How are we educating people with that success of the program?
So, I mean, I think we're in our first year. So, obviously, you know, organizations, we will be across the country talking about highlights of the program.
Mm-hmm.
Organizations who we funded, they'll be evaluating their programs for successes. We'll be looking at opportunities to scale programs. We'll be looking at opportunities for, you know, highlighting the program. So whether it's a conference where we can, you know, talk to 3,000 or 4,000 people around the effects of HIV and aging,
mm-hmm.
or if it's 250 people. So we're always looking for different opportunities and venues to really talk about, you know, HIV from an aging lens, to really showcase this initiative.
Okay. So how can an organization receive information on how to apply for some of these grants across the USA?
So, I mean, through our request for proposals, we send out emails through our listservs, but then also on our website,
mm-hmm.
Gilead.com, there are links to our request for proposals,
okay.
where they can see who we funded, they can apply for funding. Gilead also, outside of our signature initiative, has what we consider to be like rolling grants, where organizations can just apply for funding without actually going through an initiative, just to really support their programs and projects.
Oh, wow. Okay. That's pretty dope. Okay. So is it anything that we missed that our listeners need to know regarding this initiative, regarding the great company Gilead that you work for? Anything that you would like to educate our listeners on right now?
I mean, I think, you know, outside of the initiative, I think that we have to remember that HIV disproportionately affects Black communities.
Yeah.
And so, you know, if African Americans or Black Americans don't have access to adequate health care,
mm-hmm.
They live in poverty, poor access to transportation, those are all things that could exacerbate the HIV epidemic within their communities.
Yeah.
So one of the things that, you know, your listeners should be doing is to continue to have conversations with their friends, their family, their loved ones around getting tested, reducing stigma within community, maybe making it a family tradition or a partner tradition that at least once a year going to get tested. But then also understanding that there are other options to prevent HIV, pre-exposure prophylaxis. So really talking about whether that's a tool that they should use or could use to really prevent contracting HIV. So I think those are things that we have to always remember that as a black community, that we're still on the forefront of this epidemic.
Yes.
And so we need to do everything in our power to either get in care to become virally suppressed or to reduce new infections by getting on prevention treatment.
So, you know, the other day was National Black HIV and AIDS Awareness Day, 2020. And I really didn't hear, it really wasn't a buzz regarding that day.
I didn't know that was a day.
Okay, our engineer in the radio station just said she never knew that was a day. And so what can we do to bring more awareness to the community, to individuals such as our engineer here in the radio station, to let them know that we have such days to talk about how women are being affected disproportionately by HIV and AIDS right now? And so go ahead.
No, I think that's a really great point. I think we have to use our platform, like the platform that you're using now, to really educate people. I think it's sometimes left to organizations from an organizational level to promote these awareness days, where I think it should be also at an individual level. Individuals should, you know, talk about HIV, use their social media platforms, Facebook Lives, all those things that we use to push pop culture.
Mm-hmm.
I think we could use that to push, you know, HIV education, dispel myths. I think, though, that because when you think about a lot of the southern states, where majority of the black folks live, there's a stigma associated with HIV, and so we have to reduce that stigma.
Yeah.
And so that looks very different from an individual perspective, but I think that, you know, once we start reducing stigma and normalizing HIV services, so normalizing. So what I mean by that is, you know, everyone should be going to their doctor at least once a year for a physical.
Right.
And so going into that physical, to that doctor's appointment, and really being open and honest around your sexual health, it's key. And so, you know, I think from a woman's perspective, sometimes women, they may not think they're at risk because they're in a monogamous relationship or whatever the case may be.
Mm-hmm.
And so they don't talk to their doctors around risk.
Yeah.
Or doctors think that, or people think that HIV is still like a gay disease. I think that HIV is a black disease, or disproportionately affects black community regardless of their sexual orientation.
Mm-hmm.
So going into primary healthcare setting and really talking with your provider around, you know, HIV testing, STI testing, but then also options around pre-exposure prophylaxis are going to be key.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think, you know, going back to my point, it's going to be really reducing stigma within black community around HIV.
And as of 2019, the CDC reported we had approximately 17,000 African-Americans receive an HIV diagnosis here in the United States, and 12,000 of those were men, and 4,000 of those were women. And once again, it's 2020, and people are still getting diagnosed with HIV and AIDS, and so we have to drop the stigma. We have to have the conversations. We have to talk about sex because it's a natural thing, but we don't talk about it. We don't put any emphasis on it. And my engineer, she's a female black, and right now, black women, they remain 16 times higher than white women of get contracting HIV and AIDS as of 2017.
Are you serious? I did not.
Darwin, you want to talk about that?
Yeah, I mean, and I think that, you know, we want to be clear, you know, we've made a lot of progress.
Mm-hmm.
And I take off my Gilead hat and my former advocacy hat that I used to wear. We made a lot of progress. And so I think prior to 2016, we actually, in the U.S., we were averaging about 50,000 new diagnoses each year.
Mm-hmm.
And so it has kind of reduced to about 38,000 new diagnoses. And diagnosis among black women have actually declined.
Mm-hmm.
But even in diagnosis declining, we still need to do more to address HIV within black communities, specifically black women.
Yes.
When we think about black gay men, the actual diagnosis of black gay men has actually increased by, I believe, 12%.
Mm-hmm.
And so part of that has to be, if we're thinking about black women, when I ran my nonprofit years ago, you know, I talked about addressing the whole health of the person. So when
yes.
we think about black women, you know, addressing, being able to address intimate partner violence.
Yes.
Being able to address their housing insecurity
mm-hmm.
or their food insecurities or their underemployment.
Yeah.
All those things that are primary factors in someone's daily life that is far more important than, you know, their sexual health. So
right.
how do we navigate and weave all those things together
mm-hmm.
to address the whole person? So when we start addressing the whole person holistically,
yes.
I think will be a key to reducing new infections within certain populations.
I totally agree. And I think this is a great initiative that Gilead is pushing forward. And people are living longer.
Yes, that is true.
Go ahead.
Sorry. I think I heard today that the life expectancy reached 77. It was either 77 to 80.
Really?
Yes. So mm-hmm. I don't actually have the exact age for people who are living with HIV, but it is mid to late 70s.
Mm, okay. Well, that's good to know.
So, I mean, this is great information. I pray this initiative work and we can save more lives and expand people's health and expand the conversation and just treat, like you said, holistically the whole person and deal with some of this trauma that we have been dealt with or given in this life. So once again, brother, you have the floor. Anything you want to say? I know I've been jumping around everywhere, but anything you want to say before we end the call, any shout outs, anything is on you.
I mean, no, you again, you know, we talked about in this epidemic, we need people like you that use their platforms to really educate communities, especially communities of color on this epidemic. You know, again, Gilead HIV and Aging Initiative, our COPPAS initiative, which is our $100 million commitment to ending HIV in the South. And I will be remiss if I didn't talk about our Transcend initiative, which is our commitment to transgender communities.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
Transgender communities are significantly left behind when it comes to HIV prevention. So in November, we launched a nearly $5 million initiative to support trans organizations around professional development, capacity building.
Yes.
And then some micro grant making for smaller organizations to reduce HIV infections. HIV infections, not only in transgender women,
mm-hmm.
but in transgender men as well.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, Gilead is using what we like to consider this more than medicine approach.
Uh-huh.
It's going to take more than medicine to end this HIV epidemic. It's
yes.
going to take industry and community partnership to really tackle this epidemic. And so Gilead is really working extremely hard to end this epidemic within communities most at risk for HIV. And so check us out at Gilead.com to learn more about our initiatives, on our social media, Gilead Sciences, to learn more about our initiatives. Feel free to contact us at grants@Gilead.com for more information about funding. And, yeah, and just thank you, David and Gwen, for your platform to allow us to talk about this epidemic.
I thank you, brother, and I thank Gilead, and I'm glad you're in a position you're in to use your expertise, use your voice to help empower, educate, and enrich our community. So thank you again. I'll see you soon, and thanks for calling in.
Thank you. You guys have a great rest of the show.
You too. Well, we're going to take our break. This is the live show on KWAM 990 Talk Radio. We educate and empower and enrich the community. We will survive. We will make it. We are one. We are people. We are human. This is the Unleashed Voice Radio Show, the liveest show on KWAM 990 Talk Radio. We'll be right back after this pause for the call. I hold back sometimes I won't.
Choices is a nonprofit sexual health clinic in Midtown Memphis. We accept 10 care and offer patient assistance to help pay for needed services. Choices is proud to provide comprehensive reproductive health services in an LGBTQ-affirming environment. We offer a wide range of services, such as general wellness, fertility assistance, STI testing and treatment, reproductive health services for people living with HIV, including PrEP and PEP, birth control, Gardasil vaccinations, abortion services, miscarriage management, and services for trans and gender nonconforming people, including hormone replacement therapy. Everybody needs choices.
Let's talk about sex, baby.
In Memphis, condoms are free from Planned Parenthood and their friends all over town.
Nothing sexier than free. So check out freecondomsmemphis.org and get some.
Let's talk about sex.
Want to talk about sex? Talk about condoms at freecondomsmemphis.org. Get some before you get some. freecondomsmemphis.org.
Let's talk about sex, baby.
Go get tested for HIV/AIDS because HIV/AIDS has become the third leading cause of death among African Americans between the ages of 25 and 34. Even more surprising is the fact that this disease has become the leading cause of death for African American women between the ages of 25 and 34. The spread of HIV/AIDS is the single greatest health crisis currently confronting African Americans.
Join the Cathedral Praise Church of Memphis Incorporated each Sunday at 12:30 p.m. for our Spirit-filled worship service and each Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. for our Bible study. You do not want to miss these power-packed services. We are a church for all people, and we welcome you as we transform the Memphis culture. The church is located inside Bunn Presbyterian Church at 561 South Prescott Street, Memphis, Tennessee. I'm Dr. Darnell Goose, Jr., Senior Pastor of the Cathedral Praise Church of Memphis Incorporated, and I hope to see you there.
This is the city. This is their story. Some names have been changed, and so many lives have been changed too. They're going to give you the facts, just the facts. Some call this a city of crime. When they're done, it's going to be the city that cares a lot. This is the city, Memphis, Tennessee, where fearless, inspired, unfired, hungry rabble of revolutionaries has transformed hearts and minds. Not with weapons, but with their own brand of compassion, integrity, and hard work. All they're asking is for you to join their movement. It's easy to join with a donation of $20, $50, or $100. And it's all for the nonprofit organization Relationships Unleashed. With this donation, you will help enhance the three core principles of education, empowerment, and enrichment to the LGBTQ community and its allies. Go to www.relationshipunleashed.com. On the World Wide Web, relationshipunleashed.com. All donations are tax deductible. Come on, join the movement. By the way, I don't need a badge or a gun. I carry a microphone, bub.
And we're back. This is the live show on KWAM 990 Talk Radio. We educate, empower, enrich the community. We just finished a great conversation with Darwin Thompson. He's the Associate Director of Corporate Giving at Gilead Science, and he was talking about the Gilead HIV AIDS Positively Initiative, and it's a great initiative. And to find out more information, go to gilead.com, find out about it, and do your research and just get involved, man. Get involved, because now is the time to get involved, because if we let 4-6 minus 1 win.
Oh, I'm like, what's that?
Oh, my goodness. If we let 4-6 minus 1 get back into the White House, we all are in trouble. So
once again, another shocker.
Absolutely. So, if you haven't opened your eyes and woke up yet, I don't know what's going to wake you up. People should be outraged who have been in any type of criminal proceeding. Where they had jurors, they had witnesses, and you went through all this, and you see a president, a white man, go before the people and don't produce one witness, don't produce no evidence, no nothing, and he gets off. You should be outraged.
Yeah, because Senate blocked it.
Absolutely. So all them good white men in D.C. blocked it. So you should be outraged regarding that. So we got a caller. Caller, you live on the live show on KWAM 990 Talk Radio. What's on your mind?
I just decided to make this a triple threat since I called the other two shows. I didn't want you to feel left out.
Well, thanks for calling in. What's going on, David?
Oh, man, you got it. Look, pronounce his name.
Buttigieg. Buttigieg. Well, how about this? Just say Mayor Pete.
Okay, thank you, Mayor Pete, because I'm going to have problems with that.
Okay.
it's interesting to me. Here we have the worst person as president that I've seen in my lifetime.
Yes.
I concur with everything you said. And let's just be clear about this, man. Some white people said, well, we don't care if he do overthrow the country as long as he's white and Republican.
Absolutely.
I mean, that's just, you know, it's kind of like D.L. Hughley said, you know, they may not be racist, but for them, being racist is not a deal breaker.
Absolutely.
Now, here's my question.
Mm-hmm.
Now, think about how terrible that person is.
All right.
Putin puppet president.
All right.
Agent on as a human being, not even a freaking, as just a freaking human being.
Uh-huh.
But I'm going to vote for anybody. I'm an independent. But I'm going to vote for anyone that comes out of the Democratic side of the ledger who makes it through that.
I agree.
But now, let's be clear. I want to get your opinion.
All right.
Do you think that African-Americans are going to vote for gay?
So, you took me completely off my subject. Gosh. So, today we had a... within Mayor Pete's campaign, it's called a Pete Up, where you get individuals, you meet, you solicit new people to learn about the campaign. You guys sit around and talk and blase, blase, blase. So we had a Pete Up today here in Memphis, Tennessee. So shout out to all the individuals who made the Pete Up. And we were at the Piccadilly on Poplar Avenue, and we had about 15 people there, and 15 to 20 people. And so we were talking at the end of the meeting. I was the only black person there. End of the meeting, we had some more black people at the table over there. So when I got up, I was walking around hugging everybody. We had individuals from the age, let me go back, from 18 to 70 there.
Mm-hmm.
And so I got up, I was hugging everybody. It was a table of black women, a couple of black men, and they saw my bud, and they saw some people hats and shirts. And so they started laughing. And I heard one of the black women say, that's the gay president right there they over there meeting about. And like you just said, where black folk vote. America is so homophobic, but this is the issue right here. They're only homophobic, in my opinion, when a gay person is in power or a decision maker. They're not homophobic when they're directing the choir, when they're doing their hair, even if they're somebody they know. But when that person begins to get some power or want to get married, they want to use their sincere religious belief to say, I can't support that. When you do everything under the sun, you want to bring some religion in.
So what does she mean by that comment? Was she supposed to point you out? Or
no, she wasn't talking about...
Pointing that other, the president out?
That's the only thing they could say. If this guy had a wife, he would be the golden child, the golden nominee right now.
I don't understand what she meant by that.
He'd be in the closet. But if he was in the closet, he'd be fine.
Oh, absolutely. So they don't like the fact that he has owned his identity. He's a military vet. He's smart as a whip. He served his time for this country, 8 years as a mayor. He has great plans on the website. But black folk gonna have to wake up, because if we let Donald Trump get back in that office, we are in trouble, because he's already appointed 187 federal judges, the most in history by any president. And RGB, she's barely hanging on. And if that Supreme Court become conservative, we going to have a lot of stuff overturned. He said he had more judges in the pipeline. We cannot afford to let a person orientation gets in the way of our destiny. I'm going to say this, David. And he just bought all the white evangelicals. Donald Trump just passed and some of them black churches as well. He just passed a grant for $375 to churches and nonprofits where they can get $100,000 and put in a church regarding active shooters and terrorists. So they can put cameras in their church, security, anything regarding that. And you can use that money to pay for that. But he's giving $100,000 to all these churches. And you think they're not going to get that money?
Oh, no. I want to start a church.
Hello. But my point is this. They're going to say, that's the best. Hey, y'all go vote for Donald Trump because he got us all these cameras in the church. He got us security. We're safe. He gave us $100,000. Go vote for him.
We're giving $100,000 to churches, but the deficit is $1 trillion?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
No, it's more than,
yes, more than that.
She said a deficit. Okay, yeah, I think it is $1 trillion this year.
Yeah, it's a trillion. Mm-hmm.
But we get,
but the debt is, I think something, was it about 14 or something trillion dollars?
Yeah.
So I think the debt is 14, but the deficit is, like you said, I think it's around $1 trillion. Yeah, I agree with you. But I'm going to tell you something. I
didn't answer your question, though. Let me ask you a question now.
Okay,
do I think black folk going to vote for him?
Okay.
I'm going to say it's going to be half and half, David.
Okay.
Because black folk don't vote anyway. I'm going to make them mad. Y'all can get mad at me. They can call in. The number here is 901-260-5926. You black folk don't vote anyway. Y'all raise all the hell. Y'all cut up. You stand in line, go buy Jordans. You don't vote. So your vote.
Wait, hold up, brother. Did they come out for Obama?
No, Obama got in because of the white folks.
It was mixed, like you said, half and half.
Yeah, black folks don't vote. We do all this hell raising and don't vote. So it's going to be half and half. The black folk who do vote and the black folk who stay at home. So half and half, David. So the answer 50-50.
Okay. Well, let me say this.
All right.
I didn't think that I would ever see an African-American president in my lifetime.
Mm-hmm.
I would have set my house on not seeing it.
All right.
So anything is possible.
Yes.
There are things that I don't like about Mayor Pete.
Mm-hmm.
But, in fact, I freaking like, I can think of two or three that I like. Well, Booker's out of it.
Yeah.
So, that I like. But if he's a nominee, man, he gets my vote. I don't, man. And I do vote. I'm one of those few black folks that do vote.
Right.
And I think that he would make a better president. I think anybody on the Democratic side, except for that woman, that mystic woman, I don't think she's even in the race anymore. But in any case, I think anybody would make a better president. It's a low ceiling now. It's a low bar.
Yeah.
I mean, frankly, he's lowered the bar that anybody could be. But Mayor Pete, I know Booker was, but wasn't he a, what do you call it? Was he a Rhodes Scholar?
He went to Harvard, I think. Let me make sure.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. I think he may have been a Rhodes. If not, he went to Harvard, like you said. If not, you know, Oxford or Cambridge or something like that would make him, I guess, the Rhodes Scholar.
He went to Oxford and Harvard.
Well, let me tell you what I don't like about Pete.
All right.
Yeah, Pete. I don't like that money just around him.
Yeah.
But other than that, he's straight, you know. And
well, let me say this: if he didn't have the money, he'd be begging like Joe Biden is right now.
Well, that's true.
Obama got the money.
Yeah, he did, didn't he?
He did get the money.
But now he got quite a bit of small contributions too, though, didn't he?
He did, and Mayor Pete is too. But Mayor Pete needs the big money because think about it: he doesn't have a name such as Warren or Sanders. Everybody don't know him like that, so he has to get out here and do what he got to do to get his name well known.
Yeah, that's true. I don't have any money is the mother's milk of politics.
Absolutely.
One other thing.
All right.
Mayor Bloomberg, I take your money for my vote.
Oh my goodness, gosh, he's spending some money. He is spending some money.
Hey, look. Like water.
He's
like water,
it.
Man.
Yes, sir.
So that baby got some cheese, but I wish he would have stayed out and supported whoever the Democratic nominee was going to be, but it is what it is, man. So anyway, I think Mayor Pete has surprised some folks. So,
yes, he has.
Let's get it on.
We got to get Trump out of there. Thank you.
No, no doubt. All right.
Thank you. Let me hit this real quick. People may not know that here in our great state of Tennessee, our state has more anti-LGBT legislation in works than any other state in the United States. And they're calling this the slate of hate. here in Tennessee. So we had major corporations such as Amazon, Nike, American Airlines. They all have written letters to the governor to contest all of these bills that have been proposed to be passed here in the state of Tennessee. Because our great governor, Governor Lee, I'm sorry, it's 142 businesses that are sticking together. They signed this letter on Wednesday morning announcing the opposition to Tennessee recent slew of anti-LGBTQ laws. So we have one law that was passed, and it targeted this law specifically, the HB 836, which allows taxpayers, now I pay taxes, taxpayer-funded foster care and adoption agencies, like we had it here before, to discriminate against LGBTQ people.
I heard that.
And a taxpayer-funded foster care?
Right. But I thought that was a federal law, too, like they were allowing LGBT people to adopt.
Well, remember now, no. If it was a federal law, we need to look that up. If it's a federal law...
maybe I misheard wrong. Yeah. But I did hear about that bill that they didn't want them to adopt.
Absolutely.
And that wasn't right.
It passed. But my issue is, I'm a taxpayer. So if I can't adopt and I'm paying taxes, I shouldn't have to pay taxes.
Yeah, that's a good argument.
Yeah. If I can't have all of the rights, like every other citizen in the world who pays taxes, who are heterosexual, whatever, I shouldn't have to pay taxes.
Nope.
Leave me exempt.
That's a whole nother can of worms that's about to be opened. You got to put on the form your sexual orientation. Then you get me. Like, why do I have to put my sexual orientation? That's my personal business, and it's a lot.
Mm-hmm. So, but what's going to help us is companies like these 142 putting pressure on them, because Tennessee received $22 billion in tourist spending in 2018. Mm-hmm. So when these companies began to put pressure on the legislator and the governor in Tennessee, they're going to have to do something, because Amazon is in the process of adding 5,000 jobs in operation in the hub in the city right now. And this is the largest job deal ever. They're about to put 5,000 people.
That's a lot.
That's a lot. Mm-hmm. But they are on the front line of this application here in Tennessee to protest these laws.
It's a deal breaker. They could take it anywhere else. Mississippi, absolutely. Kansas, Oklahoma,
absolutely.
Washington.
And so I encourage them to leave. Don't stay here, Amazon and all these other people. For what? If they want to pass these bills and discriminate, leave. Because they have employees who work for them who may want to adopt, who can't adopt. We have other related bills, such as Bill HB 1572. This bill is against transgender students playing sports. This bill would prevent transgender school children from participating in sports consistent with their gender identity. If the school's in violation, you can lose public funding. The school administration could be fined up to $10,000 from their job. They got another bill, the license to discriminate for businesses. This bill would prevent government entities from offering incentives based on a company's non-discrimination policies. So you could just do what the hell you want to do. And it's right here in the state of Tennessee. That bathroom bill is back on the table. Yes, ma'am.
For Tennessee?
For Tennessee. It's called a HB 1274 bill / SB 1499. This bathroom bill would direct the state attorney general to defend any local school district that adopts a policy preventing transgender students from using a restroom and locker room that corresponds with their gender identity. Yes, ma'am. Matter of fact, they got another bill, the SB 1282/1369, Tennessee Natural Marriage Defense Act. This bill states that natural marriage between a man and a woman, as recognized by the people of Tennessee, remains the law in Tennessee, regardless of any court decision to the contrary. That's right here in the state of Tennessee.
That's a lot.
Oh, they ain't done yet. But my point is this. When are we going to wake up? When are we going to become politically astute, get involved, vote, care about what's going on, run for local offices, run for state offices? We have to get involved, because Once again, y'all may get mad at me. These white men are making all of the decisions for people who look like you, look like me, our Hispanic community, our Muslim community. They're making all the decisions. It's like the white man is running everything. Y'all better wake up.
Yeah.
Old white men that look like...
When you put it that way.
Hey, old white men who look like Rooster Neck up in D.C. and them old racist white men in Nashville, they're running everything. So we have to wake up and get involved. It's not about who's gay. It's not about who's straight, black, white. We have to get involved. We need more doctors, black and brown doctors, black and brown lawyers, black and brown politicians,
nurses,
everything. We have to take the power back. Because for far too long, we have fought against each other over minute and ignorant things. Who gives a care because he's married to a man? Who cares? I'm concerned about the policy. If the policies can help me, can help uplift the disenfranchised people, that's what I'm concerned about. I don't care who you're married to. But on the flip side, you people who say you support Donald Trump and believe in your religious doctrine, he's been married four times and divorced four times.
Trump has?
Yeah. I'm confused. I'm just totally confused. I'm confused.
That's the thing to do.
Yeah, but you want to say you so religious and so blah, 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 blah.
And he cheated on his wife.
That's a whole nother story.
Oh.
So when are we going to wake up? That's all I'm concerned about. But, hey, if you don't wake up, if you don't vote, if you don't get involved, trust and believe. If 4-6 minus 1 gets back in that office, he's going to run havoc on all of the people, especially the black and brown people. We're done for four more years if he gets back in that office. And I don't want to hear no complaining because you didn't vote for her. Now you're going to say you don't want to vote for him because he's married and he has momentum.
And but, who was the her? Camila?
No, Hillary Clinton.
Oh, okay.
They didn't want to vote for her, so they voted for him. Or they didn't vote for nobody because they didn't want to vote for her.
Mm-hmm.
And now we're suffering.
Weigh your options.
Please weigh your options. We have about 7 minutes. The number in the studio is 901-260-5926. The number in the studio is 901-260-5926. It's a shame. We have to get involved. We have to do something because if we don't, we are in trouble. We have a caller. Caller, you're live on the live show on KWAM 990 Talk Radio. What's on your mind?
This is G to the Q.
Hey, how you doing?
Oh, what's going on?
I thought you was a caller. I was ready to argue.
Not today.
I thought you was one of them trolls that be trolling the show.
They got to get you a nickname.
No, I got time today.
Great interview. Great interview. I listened to a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
We just made it to our destination safely.
Okay. Good.
So I just wanted to add to what you were saying about people getting out and who controlling the narrative of our lives. And I think people don't really understand that it's going to take, like, mobilizing. It's going to take black, white, brown, Latino, and yellow to mobilize together.
Mm-hmm.
Because one particular group can't do it by themselves.
Mm-hmm.
The black population is only 13% of the United States population.
Mm-hmm.
So that tells you how much of the power we control as far as this presidential election.
Yes.
It's going to take your ally friends or your neighbors that voted for Trump to have a change of heart in order to move the margin to turn this that Senate and that president.
Yes.
I'm listening.
Well, I just think it's a shame that we had a meeting today. The only thing that the people are concerned about is this man being married to a gay man. You have Joe Biden up there on the debate stage looking like he's about to fall asleep at any time. You have Bernie Sanders like he barely holding on. I'm in support of any.
He has a stent put in his heart.
Yeah, but I'm in the support of any candidate that comes out. But we need the best qualified, a new era. They're talking about experience. How much experience do you need? 50 years in the Senate? Then you want to run for president? No. So I'm all on board for whoever comes out, but we need the best candidate, and I believe that Mayor Pete is the best candidate, and I hope black folk will get on board, remove that religion doctorate and that religion rhetoric, take that and throw it out the window, and vote for policy. And, you know, the rest will be history.
That's what the Trump supporters say. They say they vote for his ability to manage the economy and, I guess, to make America great again. They could care less about how many times he's been married. They could care less about his personal interest that he's expanding in the presidential office, which is against the Constitution, how he's building resorts all over the world still. And actually, he's being sued by the District of Columbia and the Attorney General in D.C. And I think it's another state. I think it was Maryland. They're suing him about his business transactions in that office and all of the payments that he's receiving that he's not supposed to be receiving from anybody.
Well, let me correct myself. I was wrong. He was married 3 times. And cheated on his wife. He cheated on 2 of them while he was married to the previous wife.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So back to what you were saying. That came up this morning when Trump goes to, what's this thing called, his resort in Florida?
Oh.
Key Largo.
Yeah, when he goes there.
Malago.
The Secret Service pays $650 per room.
Mm-hmm.
So they have to pay to stay at his resort.
Mm-hmm.
And so taxpayers' dollars are paying to stay at his resorts.
And other countries, they're booking rooms
at
all of his entities.
Yep.
And he's making money.
Yes.
And his kids.
Yes.
Over there. His son was over in Russia. Kushner.
Yes.
We don't know why. But, you know, it's crazy.
Yeah.
It's crazy. But I just wanted to call in and add my 2 cents to it today. I see you holding it down.
Yeah, we did. We held it down. We did a great interview. It was a good interview. And I'm just I'm hoping that people will wake up. And I will be down in Mississippi. I'm going to the great state of Mississippi tomorrow with some people from Team Pete to speak at the Women Democratic meeting tomorrow on behalf of why I'm supporting Mayor Pete campaign. So y'all pray for me. I'm going to Mississippi.
What part of Mississippi?
Lord have mercy. South Haven.
You coming to? Oh, okay.
No, I'm not driving that down there, but I'm going like to South Haven somewhere. Pray for me. My car don't even like to go in Mississippi.
You'll be all right.
I don't like Mississippi, so whatever. But I'm going down to speak about why I'm giving my support to Mayor Pete, and it's important. And so we'll be down there tomorrow, myself and some more of the team members. And we're just getting out here grinding and trying to get this man in the office.
Okay. All right. Mayor Pete. All right, well, hey, I'll talk to you later.
All righty.
All right.
All right. Well, guys, we made it through another show, and we want to thank once again Darwin Thompson, the Associate Director of Gilead Science, Associate Director of Corporate Giving at Gilead Science, for calling in and educating us on the AIDS Positively Initiative, the $17.6 million in grants given to 30 organizations across the country to provide services and programs to improve the quality and the life and the health of people who are living and aging with HIV. Get involved. Do more than turning up. Get involved. Stay involved because, hey, the life you save may be your own, because these white men who are in power, they don't give 3 cents about you, and they will drink you up and spit you out and keep on moving. So I need all my people to wake up, like Spike Lee said, and do the right thing. Wake up. And let's get involved, and let's get everything that we rightfully deserve back. Because this generation wealth has been given off the sweat, blood, and tears of our ancestors, and we need to get everything back that we rightly deserve. This is the Live Show on KWAM 990 Talk Radio. This is the Unleashed Voice Radio Show, where we educate, empower, and enrich the community. We'll be back next week. Shout out to Gwen. She's out here working on the behalf of Relationship Unleashed. Shout out to her and the old lady. They're out of town doing the thing. We'll be right back next week. See y'all. Bye.
You ain't never heard a show like this. Wanna keep it real like this. Wanna play nothing but hits. And promote positiveness. Hey, got your cue on the move.